The new season is a new occasion for interesting meetings, incredible discoveries, and curious stories. My name is Konstantin Koksin. I am an ethnographer, Turkologist, traveler, full member of the Russian Geographical Society, director of the Museum of Nomadic Culture in Moscow. My name is Tinkay Kritova. I live in Kazakhstan. I study the history and culture of the Great Steppe. The culture of nomads of the Great Steppe is my favorite topic, which I have been researching for many years, and I have something to tell about it. I think that we will hear many new and unexpected facts from you. Welcome to Kazakhstan.
Kazakhstan.
Thousands of years ago, by trial and error, improving the ancient homes that have survived to this day, the nomads of the Great Steppe created a perfect home, mobile, light, demountable, suitable for the life of those who are always on the move. Two types of yurts have survived to this day, Mongolian and Turkic. Here, in the sacred land of Kazakhstan, we will talk about the Kazakh yurt.
Казахской юрте.
What does the word yurt itself mean? I know that among the Altai peoples, yurt is generally more than just a dwelling. It is a whole nation, and even being in principle. There is one more meaning. A yurt is a territory where a certain clan roams. Housing, this is what Russians call a house, made of felt and wood. What yurt are you from? From that yurt. Therefore, this house will be called a yurt. So this word was fixed in Russian and got into other languages. The Mongols called the yurt gir. What about the Kazakhs? Kiz uy. Kyrgyz says, Boz uy. Yurt is an amazing home. Now, here under the sky of the steppe, we will talk about its internal structure, and later about how to make a yurt. We'll talk about that inside this interesting home. I want to talk with you about the symbolic meaning of a yurt. After all, a yurt for a nomad is not just a house, it is a model of the universe. When the dome of the forever blue sky is above us, so the yurt has a domed roof. A yurt, in fact, is a nomad space model. Shanirak is a door to the sky, from where Tingri looks at his children. The oldest sign known to all the peoples of the earth is a cross inscribed in a circle. We see this sign on the flag of Kyrgyzstan, on the coat of arms of Kazakhstan. In the Mongolian culture, the ancient Tengrian sign slightly changed under the influence of Buddhism. Now the Mongolian Tono, as Shanirak is called in Mongolia, is an eight-spoke wheel. That is, it symbolizes eight steps of the noble Buddhist path. The crosshair resembles an ancient sign. It is called Alzie. The knot of happiness is an endless road without beginning and end. One of the Buddhist symbols, a noble Buddhist path, the path of enlightenment. This is how interesting world religions are. They adapt ancient symbols to their needs. Shanirak, as far as I remember, translates as door to heaven.
Вот как интересно, мировые религии, древние символы приспосабливают к своим нуждам. Киргизы между собой называются...
The Kyrgyz call it Shanirak Tunduk, which in translation means a lid of a boiler, a pan or a cauldron. There is an ancient word, Chanirek. As they explained to me, a symbolic translation is a door to heaven. There is an ordinary earthly door. We leave, we go in, and there is a door through which the sky itself watches us. Shanirak is, in fact, a deeply sacred symbol. There are the poles that intersect, six poles, and they form nine crosshairs. Nine is a sacred number. The Kazakh yurt is an amazing openwork construction. Until covered by felt carpets, kiz, it seems to soar above the ground. The sun with rays rests on the gratings. The gratings are square in cross-section.
Квадрат или ромб – древнейший символ Матери Земли.
A square or rhombus is the oldest symbol of Mother Earth, known to all peoples in Eurasia, in Africa, and even North, South America. A square with a dot in the center is a field where something grows, an ancient sign of farmers. Here it symbolizes Умай, Mother Earth. In Kazakh yurts, the door is always installed to the northeast. Why? In the east, the sun rises. The ancient nomads believed in the power of the sun, worshipped nature and the sky. What is curious in the Mongolian yurt, where the door is set strictly to the south, there is another explanation. According to Mongolian beliefs, the next Buddha, Maitreya, will come from the north. Therefore, the altar on the north side, called the koima, is where honored guests are seated. However, it is the same in any yurt, in particular the Kazakh one. As the sun rises in the east, the sunbeam begins to move along the walls of the yurt. Often, the animals of the ancient Eastern calendar are depicted on the dome. However, these are not years. Yes, nomads are hasty people, but it is impossible to forget which year you live in. This is a watch. The Mongols say like this: the hour of the bull, the hour of the dragon, the hour of the snake, the hour when the bull went to visit the tiger, the hour when the snake almost caught up with the horse. They are not at all confused that the days in winter are shorter, in summer are longer. One Mongolian hour, which is defined as 1.5 to 2 astronomical hours. Nevertheless, they call their time very poetically. Moreover, yurts are divided into 12 sectors. Say, I forgot where I had put my things. I ask my wife, where are my mittens? Look where the dog starts to move. True. That is, each sector has its own name. Practically, yes. Is there such a thing in the Kazakh yurt? Well, at least I haven't heard about this. The Kazakh yurt is clearly divided into male and female guest parts, where young, unmarried girls can sit, where they cannot, etc. As for the watch, unfortunately, I did not hear about it. Because for me, it was interesting to know that the Kazakhs preserved the ancient animal style in this calendar. It is no secret that the Chinese, after all, invented it thousands of years ago, watching the luminaries. This is a 12-year cycle, and not a single culture develops in isolation. Travelers from China came to the steppe. The steppe dwellers came to China both as friends and as enemies. Of course, the theme with animals got into the steppe, and the same calendar is known in Tengrinism. The Mongols call it Buddhist, the Chinese, Chinese, but it is easier to call it Oriental. We have the concept of a Tengrian calendar. Of course, cultures were mixed. My first Kazakh fairy tale is just the same, the fairy tale about how the calendar was invented, about the mouse that deceived everyone, that climbed onto the head of the bull and was the first to cross the river. But in the Kazakh fairy tale, it did not cross the river. In the Mongolian one, not everyone crossed the river. Our mouse climbed onto a camel's head and looked in the right direction, east. Therefore, the first year is its, and the camel, because of its pride, that it said that it would see the first, was left without a year.
А у монголов верблюда нет. Все-таки ближе Китай, наверное, это классический.
But the Mongols have no camels. They're closer China, the classic Chinese circle. The bull crossed the first river. Because according to legend, the Han accomplished many feats and said, tell me about the deeds of my father and grandfather. When my father and grandfather defeated the enemies, the scientists at the court announced completely different dates. Han realized that they would talk nonsense about his feats and ordered them to come up with a calendar system. The wisest of the wisest said, the first year, the second, the 12th. Han thought it was boring, but he agreed that let there be numbers. In honor of the invention of the calendar, the Han announced a huge paid hunt. The soldiers of Genghis Khan drove some of the animals to the river, but some of the animals broke out of the hunting ring and rushed into the water. The Han watched them crossing the water. Then it dawned on him, whoever crosses the first, there were 12 animals that will be called on the calendar. The bull, the most powerful animal, was the first to swim across the river, but the mouse was sitting on it. The mouse jumped down first, and the 12-year cycle begins with the mouse. The bull became the second, and so the names appeared. Of course, this is a Mongolian legend written on the basis of the Chinese one. Therefore, there was no place left for the camel. Poor thing. A yurt is not only a temple that can be transported with you. It is the whole life of a nomad. A yurt is a space where you are safe. For example, according to Mongolian beliefs, in no case should anybody step on the doorstep. Do Kazakhs have this? Sure, you cannot step on the doorstep, and we enter the yurt only from the right foot. For the Mongols, a doorstep is a sacred space. Under it, a woman bury her hairs, nails cut off her child, to remove the evil eye, the same thing. Quite right, and during the reign of Genghis Khan, if a person put his foot on the doorstep of a yurt, his head was immediately chopped off. At the same time, Genghis Khan, who created the Yasa, the law of justice, was a truly fair person. Once, at the headquarters of the Mongol Khan, the grandson of Genghis Khan, the ambassador of the Pope, arrived. He came in and, according to European tradition, wiped his dirty boots right on the doorstep of the yurt. It was a nightmare. They tied his hands, went to chop his head off. I did not know. I did not know. I did not know. I am passing through. Han, the grandson of Genghis Khan, said, he really did not know. Let him go. He is not required to comply with the laws of a foreign country if you did not know. But if he does so again, chop off his head. Doorstep space, the hearth in the center. Nowadays, potbelly stoves are installed, but in the shape of a hearth. It is round among the Mongols, which symbolizes the circle of life, the endless movement of history in a circle. While among the Kyrgyz, Kazakhs, the traditional shape is triangular, where three angles symbolize three generations that live near the fire. According to Mongolian beliefs, Otkhan Galakhan, the owner of the fire, lives in the hearth. The fire feeds everyone, warms, so the first drop of milk on the ring finger is thrown into the fire. The first piece of meat is obligatory for the fire. Mother Earth, Mother Fire, Mother Umay. It is interesting that the mother of Genghis Khan was from the cult Mongol tribe Honghirat, a unit of Olkhunut, from the island of Olkhan. We also know that Konirats are direct descendants of the Honirats. Monument of Oilin, the mother of the people, in grandeur is not inferior to the monument of Genghis Khan. Perhaps this motherhood came from there and entrenched here. That is, the maternal principle is connected with the Kazakh land.
Материнское начало, оно связано с казахской землей.
Скажи, пожалуйста.
Please tell me about do's and don'ts, telling where you can tie a horse or a camel near a yurt.
У монголов говорят так.
The Mongols say this. Happy is the owner close to whose yurts the horses of the guest graze. They dig in a hitch with Buddhist symbols, or according to ancient Tengrian symbols, this is the sun and the moon, and the knot of happiness below. There are three cuts above it. This is the world axis, the world tree, and three worlds. Lower, middle, upper one. One, two, three, horses are tied to a hitching post. But if the owner is truly hospitable, he digs in two pillars, stretches a rope between them, so that the herd can be tied. The Mongols measured themselves by the length of this rope. The longer the rope, the more hospitable host. I heard about the ban on tying horses in front of a yurt, near the door. Only from the back could they be left. There was even such a law. If a horse kicks a child behind a yurt, the owner of the horse will not be guilty. But if in front of it, then he will have to bear the blame. We are on purpose near an authentic shepherd's yurt. That is, today it is used for livestock breeding. It is not as elegant, not as big, maybe, as other yurts. Now I think we should go to a rich Kazakh yurt and see how it is arranged inside.
И посмотреть, как она устроена внутри.
Согласна.
Вперед. Ну что ж, зайдем.
Well, let's go to the Kazakh yurt. Please step over the doorstep, the sacred space in any home. To the right of the entrance, there is a female side. There are motors, dishes. A woman works here. Look what handy bags are for transporting dishes so they don't break. Hanging shelves. That is, all this is quickly disassembled and transported to the right place. On the left, there is a male side. A trap. A gun, in general, nothing else. Although sometimes there are saddles here, what a man uses. The door is richly decorated. In general, swing doors appeared not so long ago. In the 19th century and earlier, only very rich buys had them. Before that, just a door, chihi, was hung up. What is chihi? Chihi is a grass mat that is placed around a yurt. Moreover, sometimes they put it directly in the lattice, outside the felt. It has the only task, when a yurt of a Turkic type is ventilated, Kyrgyz, Kazakh, Turkmen, the felt is raised, the shinrock is opened. Air passes freely, and it is always cooler in the yurt than outside, which amazes travelers. It is plus 40 degrees, as we have today, and while it is plus 20 degrees in the yurt. But poisonous insects, snakes, can climb into a yurt, where there are children, where people sit. Therefore, chihi is stuck in the ground, ventilation is provided, poisonous creatures cannot climb. The Mongols do not know what is chihi. They just raise the felt and look through the bars at the step. A few words about the difference between various types of yurts. What is the difference between the Kazakh yurt and the Kyrgyz one? The first is a frequency of the details of kirigir, gratings. The Kyrgyz yurt has rather large windows. In the Kazakh one, they are much more dense. That is, it takes more work, more camel skin, which pulls the parts together. Well, the difference from the Mongolian is S-shaped bend detail. When the load falls from above, the grate springs and discards snow. The Mongolian is simply bent inward. It is like a very streamlined ball. It protects from the wind. In Moscow, in the Museum of Nomadic Culture, we have yurts of various types. In winter, we clean the Mongolian one from snow. Kyrgyz and Kazakh ones, no. They stand in the snow, then suddenly throw snow off themselves. Moreover, the effect is fantastic, as if the dog shook itself, and the snow flies off, and it stands untouched. The ingenious invention of the nomads of Central Asia.
Эффект фантастический, как собака вот собралась и отряхнулась, и снег слетает, и она стоит нетронутая. Гениальное изобретение кочевников Средней Азии.
I remember that the Kyrgyz yurts are more elongated, and the Kazakh ones are more mundane. Why did this happen? It is not always so. It all depends on where the family wanders. Say, if the Kyrgyz family descends to the plain, to the steppe, they will set up the yurt lower, since the yurt allows this to be done to protect it from the wind. If the Kazakh family ascends the mountains, they will try to put the yurt higher, so that the snow comes off more easily. In Moscow, we set up the Kazakh yurt higher, so that the snow rolled down from it. That is, a yurt is a transforming toy. It can be bigger, smaller. Big yurts use a central bagan, a pillar to support the dome, sometimes two pillars. There are variations. Kazakhs living in Mongolia use Mongolian elements. Say they use a Mongolian door. It is much more convenient and simpler and lighter than traditional Kazakh yurt. Amazing! There is a Kazakh yurt with a Mongolian door. Why? Because it is convenient. I know that this rope is called alajib in Kazakh. It has a sacred meaning. Once it was made black and white from sheep's wool into a solid lasso. It served sacred protective purposes. Yes, that's right. They began to paint it quite late. Initially, the wool was black and white, so the costumes were black and white. The first ropes are black and white, a combination of two forces, two elements. And now let's move on to the sacred or guest side.
Или гостевую сторону, или хозяйскую сторону юрты. Хозяйская или...
the guest side or the sacred side of the home. For any nation, the sacred side is opposite the entrance to the house. Here on the sacred side, we have chests and various blankets, korpishe, and of course, carpets, kuiz. But the carpet is not just warm, not just wealth. Kuiz is writing. This is the ancient history of the genus recorded in carpets. Not everyone wrote on paper, parchment. There are different ways to record knowledge. So the more carpets here, the more ancient the clan is, the more glorious the clan is. Well, what are the most valuable things? Here are the chests. Look what kind of bonework, what kind of inlay. Rich people owned these because the simple nomads had rough, wooden, with a modest ornament, not even painted.
Богатые люди такими владели, потому что простых кочевников были грубые, деревянные, хорошо, если со скромным орнаментом, даже не раскрашенные. Амзе Нурсид?
Amzia Nursid, a museum employee in Otirar, said that when enemies attacked, men who were sitting on the male side were often killed with long knives. Here, the owner was sitting, and chests were placed for protection. That is, a man not only protects wealth on the one hand, but on the other hand, this chest protects him. You can't pierce it with any saber.
Кто-то играет музыкальные инструменты на стенах. Сидельные сумки, то, что сзади седла вешается, перевозится.
There are necessarily musical instruments on the walls if someone plays music. Saddlebags are what are hung, carried behind the saddle, and kamchas, a whip that has so many symbols, so many purposes. That is, as far as I know, the Kyrgyz favorite game is kizgumay, catch up with a girl. The Kazakhs have kizgu.
Камчой. Отец девушки демонстративно так слегка стягает похитителей. Дочь, как ты могла с ним сбежать, потом уже играют свадьбу. Какая старинная хорошая колыбель.
What an old good cradle, a very comfortable handle. That is, a woman could take it, carry it with her, to milk cattle, to shake cradle, to transfer it. The child is covered, no one, even flies, would bother him.
Бишик.
Бишик is considered a sacred item. There is a belief that the health and fate of the child will depend on how carefully the master made it. Therefore, they traditionally order бишик from a very good master.
Очень хорошего мастера.
A bishik was not suspended anywhere. Did it always stand on the floor? Well, normally they were put on the floor, because there are cradles that are suspended. This is one type of cradle. There is a cradle that is carried. Nomads usually have such a cradle. I saw them in Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Iran, among different peoples. Bishik legends are legends that date back to the distant past. If he hears a lullaby, he will remember his genus, where he comes from. This is one of the most important elements. In Kyrgyz, it is called Alabakan. And what about Kazakh? Adalbakan. They hang clothes here. Sometimes they put two. But if there is one and it is richly decorated, forged, painted, this is a symbol of the world axis, the axis that holds everything on itself. A woman, when she gives birth, clings to this pillar, the world axis.
Когда юрту собираешь, важно правильно надеть войлоки в правильной очередности.
When assembling a yurt, it is important to put felt in the correct order. Otherwise, all beauty will be outside and will become wet. Here are decorative elements that carry a special meaning. These are ancient amulets, like these trusses. In pre-Islamic times, these ropes, ribbons, tied to everything, were a sacrifice to spirits, and as it were, landing sites for spirits. That is, the more ribbons, the more good will be in the house.
Казахская юрта от киргизской и монгольской – это спальный полог.
The difference between the Kazakh yurt and the Kyrgyz and Mongolian ones is the sleeping canopy, that is, the bed. Wooden beds are also typical for the Mongols, the Kyrgyz, the Kazakhs, and the Turkmens. But only among the Kazakhs did I see that the sleeping canopy was closing. The first thought was that everything is strict in Islam. You need to close it, change clothes. But the Kyrgyz are also Muslims, and they have no sleeping canopies. Everything is open. And here is the bed itself. I know that Kazakh beds are of this shape. The headboard is slightly raised, and where the legs are, yes, such a cup, right? It is very ergonomic, provides a good rest. This form allows the back to rest after a long jump. When a man grazed sheep all day, he needs to rest. In this regard, the Mongolian bed is flatter and only covered with sheepskin. That is, not all nomads used this shape, did they? Not in all cultures. In general, beds were different if they were in the yurt, because many nomads did not have beds. Well, let's say, in cold climates, beds were used in the winter. When it is minus 40, it would be really difficult without a bed. If a large family lived in the yurt, not everyone slept in beds. One bed was for the head of the family. Dad is tired. He spent 2 days in the saddle, so children do not disturb him sleeping. Here, on the female side, there are beds for grandmothers, either for a confined woman or for a mother with a baby. Well, it's obvious, to make them calm, otherwise no one will fall asleep. If there is an old man, then they put a bed here, to the sacred side. He is already closer to the higher forces. And everyone else slept on the floor. Fortunately, there were lots of blankets in the chest. For example, these blankets are enough for all of our crew to spend the night here in comfort. It is curious that in the era of the Tang Dynasty, the great emperor Taizong managed to reconcile the steppe men, Turks of the first Haganate, and the Chinese. The Chinese were fascinated by the steppe culture. The Chinese could put yurts in the courtyard of their house. I want to recite to you the poem of the famous Chinese poet Bo Jui, who was the favorite of the Taizong dynasty, who glorified the Turkic yurt.
Шерсть собрали с тысячи овец, выковали сотни две колец.
The wool was gathered from 1,000 sheep. They forged 200 rings for me. Firm framework of coastal willows, durable, fresh, comfortable, and beautiful. In a northern, clear blueness, warrior put a yurt on the grass, and now, like a blue haze, together with him, it came south. Whirlwind cannot shake the yurt. It becomes harder due to the rain. Felt is a wall against hoarfrost. It is not scared of snowfall. It is prettier for me to enter a yurt than to enter a house. Drunk, I sleep on dry felt. Hearth of crimson lights merrily weave in the shade. Frozen ink, and now the verse, like a waterfall in spring, flows. Even to the canopy of orchards. Do not lure people out of these yurts. The prince covered his palaces with carvings. What are they next to? A blue yurt.
Даже в дивный сад из орхидей не сманить из этих юрт людей. Хан свои дворцы покрыл резьбой. Что они пред юртой голубой?
So the Chinese glorified the Turkic yurt, and we are the heirs of the Turks.
Если вспомнить
Heavenly Turks, the predecessors of the Huns, called themselves heavenly messengers. If we recall the steppe at dawn, the feather grass steppe, or the steppe at sunset, it seems to be greenish-blue. Kazakh Kok is both green and blue. The color of the steppe sea, the color of the eternal blue sky. I have been in the yurt many times, but every time I discover something new for myself. You're right. Probably, a yurt is the whole cosmos of a nomad. It is a microcosm, and to understand it, you need to live in it. You know, it's great to open the door of the Kazakh yurt and meet the dawn, as we have met it here today in Jai Lao.
Забавнейшая история, которая случилась со мной лично.
This funny story happened to me personally. I spent 10 years in a yurt in the center of Moscow with my wife. When my parents got old, I bought a summer cottage next door to them. There was a house, a hut, a Russian stove. But after having lived in the circular space of the yurt, I realized that I could not live in a square room. So my wife and I put Native American teepee in the yard. Then cold winds blew out, snow fell. The hearth no longer warmed us. So we, very carefully, scared of a square space, moved into a hut, began to master it. That is, I myself went this way. The transition from nomadic life to sedentary. Still, I prefer to live in a yurt, because when you wake up from the singing of birds, you hear how the grass grows, you see the stars through the dome. You cannot experience this in any apartment or house.
слышишь, как растет трава, через купол видишь звезды. Ни в одной квартире, ни в одном доме.
And I, like the poet Bo Jui, will never exchange a yurt for a Han's palace, because a yurt is a round space, life without corners, real and internal ones. In a yurt, you feel that you are part of this world, part of the universe of nomads.
Частью вселенной кочевников.